Von Tunapanda. Very happy and grateful for this opportunity to present our work that we are doing. Our organization is called Tunapanda Institute, and it was started in 2014. What we do is that we train young people in tech, design, and business for a period of 3 months. After that, some of them join our team as apprentices, while others we try to place them into employment. One challenge that we saw in our program is that we were receiving so many applications and we were only able to accommodate 25 students at a time. And our location is in Kibera. The population of Kibera, according to the World Economic Forum, is 700,000 people. Most of them, especially the youth, are not able to get employment in the formal sector. So you will find that as a youth in Kibera, it's actually up to you after you finish Form 4 or you finish Class 8 to decide the path in which your life is going to go. So you find that most of them are actually involved in crime, and then some get employment in the informal settlement, informal sector, which is not like very reliable. So as Tunapanda Institute, our focus was that we wanted to empower young people so that they do not just become employed, but we wanted to create like a value system so that when you go through our program, you're able actually to learn and develop skills that will enable you to prosper in the 21st century. And it is because of that challenge that the idea of Tunapanda Net came up. So at first, what we wanted to do was just decentralized learning. We have these educational resources in our facility, and our goal was just like, let us go and connect a few areas, create a few hotspots around Kibera, so that anyone can be able to access our educational content. So this, we did a video, which we posted on YouTube. And luckily, we were able to get a donation of ubiquity equipment, nano stations, that this is me and my team deploying in our first partner organization. So one thing about us, we didn't really know what we were doing. So we didn't know we were a community network. We were just trying things out. And that's actually landed, like, we fried almost all the ubiquity equipment that we had because the reset buttons got broken, we didn't know how to install them. So it was a good learning experience for us, but we are very grateful for the community that we have right now, because now we are able to reach out to people to help us whenever we get stuck. So another key learning during our first pilot was that just deploying the network in itself will not be able to work unless you have the human interaction. So our since we met last time, our update has been that we have been trying to create a community of champions of the community network. So how do we work with our local community to be able for them to be able to champion the community network? And we figured out that if we focus on three key areas, we'd be able actually to reach the people in Kibera. So our main focus has been around healthcare, education, and businesses. And since education is our strong point as Tunapanda, we decided that let us first focus on education and then grow to healthcare and businesses as the network grows. So we were looking out for partnership. Mishuki has been of great support to us, and his advice was look for low-hanging fruit. So we want to look for community members who are ready to pick up the idea and run with it without necessarily having to go there and convince them severally. So our first center is going to be a Trailer Education Center. This is a primary school and also a secondary school. So the primary has 500 plus students and the secondary has about 400 students. The school is mostly for the underprivileged kids in Kibera who are able to go. One thing we loved about the school is that through the local leadership, they were able to get a new building. So for us, a plus was that it enabled us to connect to the other sites in case you wanted to. And they also have a fiber optic connection. So when we went to approach the school the first time, and we went and pitched the idea of the network, the principal was like, I don't need you guys, we already have fiber optic connected to us. And then we asked him, then, what are you doing with it? And he was like, my teachers here are able to Google information. But surely when you connect to the teachers, you find that, yes, the fiber optic exists, yes, there's connectivity, but really the teachers are not using it in education. So one thing we have learned is that, yes, there's no, like, the connection between the value of ICT and how to be able to be implemented. So that is a key area that we are going to focus with this partner, is that we want to be able to understand where they are and also be able to help them see how ICT can be used for education. A challenge with ICT is not, it's not like making a cake. So you know that if you mix this, you're able, this is the end result. So it's a trial and error. And we find that very many communities are not, especially the community that we are dealing with, it's not very open. So we have to find a way to balance the expectations so that they don't expect like it's going to rapidly change their lives, but it's actually going to impact them step by step. Our next center, we got partnered with an organization called Umande Trust, and what they do is they build biocenters in slum and rural areas. So this is one of their biocenters, and it serves about 1,000 to 3,000 people in Kibera. The challenge in slum areas is because of how the infrastructure is. There is no access to toilets and bathrooms. So a biocenter like this, you get people from around the community coming to use it. And also because of the methods of cooking in Kibera, very many people suffer from headaches. They also get chest pains. So one of the motivation of also having a biocenter is that you can be able to produce biogas that the community can be able to use. So far, they have not piped the biogas to their different homes, but what they are doing is that they have like a small kitchen where community members can come and be able to use the bell center. This also serves as a community space, so very many young people come into this space to either watch football during the evening, and they also have like this small computer lab. So when we went there, we found these kids who are playing games. The people who run this particular center, someone donated to them computers and then left. So this is the situation that we are finding in most areas, that just giving them the technology is not enough, but actually you have to train them as to what they can be able to use it for. So these kids were playing games, and just from our interaction with them, we asked them what they think they want to be able to do, and they said they want to do to be computer specialists. So working with a center like this, because they already have computers in place, we know that we'll be able to facilitate ICT training, which is sort of also our key area in Tunapan. And the last of our pilot is a school called St. Christine, which is also a biocenter. And interacting with the founder, he told us that he used to work at a farm. He used to have like an 8-to-5 job, and then he realized that living in Kibera, so many children were not able to access education. So he started actually like renting a church space, but through his passion, through his vision, he has now a full-fledged school. They also have received donations. So this is like a box. Some of you have heard of Brick. This is sort of similar to Brick. So you have tablets in this suitcase, and then you're able to recharge them. They also received a donation of computers. The same challenge that you met in Raila, the other school is the same challenge you met here. So you find that they have computers, but they really do not know what to do with them. So it really integrating ICT into education is a key area that you're going to focus on. We've seen the government of Kenya also getting into that space, so we look either to collaborate with them, and also someone mentioned about generating the good data that actually we can be able to prove that really ICT in education works. This is the map. So the red, you're able to see Lake Tuna is where our center is, where our headquarters is, Tunapanda Institute, and then the connection to St. Christine. So St. Christine is the farthest. Raila is a bit near, and the good thing is that from Raila, you're actually able to see Tosha. So we were very happy with the partners that we were able to get, because also just because the buildings that they're offering us are really like very stable for us to be able to use. So the main service for phase one that we'll be offering is we'll be offline education. We also want to focus on training the teaching staff in ICT education and also training ICT skills for employability and entrepreneurship today. So being that in Tunapanda, we just graduated our seventh cohort, and most of the ones who go through our program, so our employment rate right now is at 70%. So we hope to use these key learnings actually to now to reach out to the community even deeper, work with the community centers to be able to train young people either to be employed or either to find employment. Key learnings from our whole process was that getting the community buy-in. In Kibera, you find there's so many NGOs. And what I can say is that initially, NGOs will just come and give people money. So the mindset is that even if I want to take a photo of a resident in Kibera, they can ask me for money because they think that maybe I'm going to use it to sell it somewhere or I'm getting money from a particular donor. So getting the community by setting the expectations right from the start has been like a challenge. We have been turned away. We have been given empty promises, but we are grateful for so far for what you've done. And then local content is the connectivity between what ICT can do really in Africa. What can ICT do for someone who is living in Kibera? So most of the solutions that you find online are actually like examples from the West, as Carlos cited. Fostering collaboration, we find that the schools, different schools have different resources. So what we want to be able to do right now is to foster collaboration within them so that they are not competing, but they can see what resources they can be able to share. Local champions for the network, we need local leadership who are able now to really like buy into our vision and follow it up. Human-centered design approach is sort of similar to what was mentioned, that participatory action research. We find that so I'm sort of a techie, I'm a network engineer, and when I went in, I had all these solutions in my mind of what I'm going to do. But just what I learned is that you really have to sit down with the community and assess what their needs are before you're able even to create like a solution for them. So very grateful to our partners and our collaborators, Internet Society. Without them, we would not have the vision would not have come to life. RhinoTBT is from Denmark and they are donating indoor routers to us. ICTP is the one that introduces the concept of community networks even before we knew what we were doing. Network for eLab, which is in Cambridge University, has really helped us, and Humanitas for connecting us to these partners. Thank you very much.